after the Philistines captured the Ark of God, they took it from the battleground at Ebenezer to the city of Ashdod. They carried the Ark of God into the temple of Dagon and placed it beside the idol of Dagon. But when the citizens of Ashdod went to see it the next morning, Dagon had fallen with his face to the ground in front of the Ark of the Lord. So they set the idol up again. But the next morning the same thing happened. The idol had fallen face down before the Ark of the Lord again. This time his head and hands had been broken off and were laying in the doorway. Only the trunk of his body was left intact. That is why to this day neither the priest of Dagon nor anyone who enters the temple of Dagon will step on its threshold. Then the Lord began to afflict the people of Ashdod and the nearby villages with a plague of tumors. When the people realized what was happening, they cried out, "We can't keep the Ark of the God of Israel here any longer. He is against us. We will all be destroyed along with our god Dagon." So they called together the rulers of the five Philistine cities and asked, "What should we do with the Ark of the God of Israel?" The rulers discussed it and replied, "Move it to the city of Gath." So they moved the Ark of the God of Israel to Gath. But when the Ark arrived at Gath, the Lord began afflicting its people, young and old, with a plague of tumors, and there was a great panic. So they sent the Ark of God to the city of Ekron. But when the people of Ekron saw it coming, they cried out, "They are bringing the Ark of the God of Israel here to kill us too." So the people summoned the rulers again and begged them, "Please send the Ark of the God of Israel back to its own country, or it will kill all of us." For the plagues from God had already begun, and great fear was sweeping across the city. Those who didn't die were afflicted with tumors, and there was weeping everywhere. The Ark of the Lord remained in Philistine territory 7 months in all. Then the Philistines called in their priests and diviners and asked them, "What should we do about the Ark of the Lord? Tell us how to return it to its own land. Send the Ark of the God of Israel back along with a gift." They were told, "Send a guilt offering so the plague will stop. Then, if the plague doesn't stop, you will know that the God didn't send the plague after all." "What sort of guilt offering should we send?" they asked. And they were told, "Since the plague has struck both you and your five rulers, make 5 gold tumors and 5 gold rats, just like those that have ravaged your land. Make these things to show honor to the God of Israel. Perhaps then he will stop afflicting you, your gods, and your land. Don't be stubborn and rebellious as Pharaoh and the Egyptians were. They wouldn't let Israel go until God had ravaged them with dreadful plagues. Now build a new cart and find 2 cows that have just had calves. Make sure the cows have never been yoked to a cart. Hitch the 2 cows to the cart, but shut the calves away from them in a pen. Put the Ark of the Lord on the cart, and beside it place a chest containing the gold rats and gold tumors. Then let the cows go wherever they want. If they cross the border of our land and go to Beth Shemesh, we will know it was the Lord who brought this great disaster upon us. If they don't, we will know that the plague was simply a coincidence and was not sent by the Lord at all." So these instructions were carried out. 2 cows with newborn calves were hitched to the cart, and their calves were shut up in a pen. Then the Ark of the Lord and the chest containing the gold rats and gold tumors were placed on the cart. And sure enough, the cows went straight along the road towards Beth Shemesh, lowering as they went. The Philistine rulers followed them as far as the border of Beth Shemesh. The people of Beth Shemesh were harvesting wheat in the valley, And when they saw the ark, they were overjoyed. The cart came into the field of a man named Joshua and stopped beside a large rock. So the people broke up the wood of the cart for a fire and killed the cows and sacrificed them to the Lord as a burnt offering. Several men of the tribe of Levi lifted the ark of the Lord and the chest containing the gold rats and gold tumors from the cart and placed them on the large rock. Many burnt offerings and sacrifices were offered to the Lord that day by the people of Beth Shemesh. The five Philistine rulers watched all this and then returned to Ekron the same day. The five gold tumors that were sent by the Philistines as a guilt offering to the Lord were gifts from the rulers of Ashdod, Gaza, Ashkelon, Gath, and Ekron. The five gold rats representing the five Philistine cities and their surrounding villages, which were controlled by the five rulers. The large rock at Beth Shemesh, where they set the ark of the Lord, still stands in the field of Joshua as a reminder of what happened there. But the Lord killed 70 men from Beth Shemesh because they looked into the ark of the Lord, and the people mourned greatly because of what the Lord had done. Who is able to stand in the presence of the Lord, this holy God? They cried out. Where can we send the ark from here? So they sent messengers to the people at Kirjath-Jearim and told them, the Philistines have returned the ark of the Lord. Please come here and get it. So the men of Kirjath-Jearim came to get the ark of the Lord. They took it to the hillside home of Abinadab and ordained Eliezer, his son, to be in charge of it. The ark remained in Kirjath-Jearim for a long time. 20 years in all. During that time, all Israel mourned because it seemed that the Lord had abandoned them. Then Samuel said to all the people of Israel, if you are really serious about wanting to return to the Lord, get rid of your foreign gods and your images of Ashtoreth. Determined to obey only the Lord, then he will rescue you from the Philistines. So the Israelites destroyed their images of Baal and Ashtoreth and worshipped only the Lord. Then Samuel told them, come to Mizpah, all of you. I will pray to the Lord for you. So they gathered there and in a great ceremony drew water from a well and poured it out before the Lord. They also went without food all day and confessed that they had sinned against the Lord. So it was at Mizpah that Samuel became Israel's judge. When the Philistine rulers heard that all Israel had gathered at Mizpah, they mobilized their army and advanced. The Israelites were badly frightened when they learned that the Philistines were approaching. Plead with the Lord our God to save us from the Philistines, they begged Samuel. So Samuel took a young lamb and offered it to the Lord as a whole burnt offering. He pleaded with the Lord to help Israel, and the Lord answered. Just as Samuel was sacrificing the burnt offering, the Philistines arrived for battle. But the Lord spoke with a mighty voice of thunder from heaven, and the Philistines were thrown into such confusion that the Israelites defeated them. The men of Israel chased them from Mizpah to Beth-Kar, slaughtering them all along the way. Samuel then took a large stone and placed it between the towns of Mizpah and Jeshanah. He named it Ebenezer, the Stone of Help. For he said, up to this point, the Lord has helped us. So the Philistines were subdued and didn't invade Israel again for a long time. And throughout Samuel's lifetime, the Lord's powerful hand was raised against the Philistines. The Israelite town near Ekron and Gath that the Philistines had captured were restored to Israel, along with the rest of the territory that the Philistines had taken. And there was also peace between Israel and the Amorites in those days. Samuel continued as Israel's judge for the rest of his life. Each year he traveled around, setting up his court first at Bethel, then at Gilgal, and then at Mizpah. He judged the people of Israel at each of these places. Then he would return to his home at Ramah, and he would hear cases there too. And Samuel built an altar to the Lord at Ramah. As Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons to be judges over Israel. Joel and Abijah, his oldest sons, held court in Beersheba, but they were not like their father, for they were greedy for money. They accepted bribes and perverted justice. Finally, the leaders of Israel met at Ramah to discuss the matter with Samuel. "Look," they told him, "you are now old and your sons are not like you. Give us a king like all the other nations have." Samuel was very upset with their request and went to the Lord for advice. "Do as they say," the Lord replied, "for it is me they are rejecting, not you. They don't want me to be their king any longer. Ever since I brought them from Egypt, they have continually forsaken me and followed other gods. And now they are giving you the same treatment. Do as they ask, but solemnly warn them about how a king will treat them." So Samuel passed on the Lord's warning to the people. "This is how a king will treat you," Samuel said. "The king will draft your sons into his army and make them run before his chariots. Some will be commanders of his troops, while others will be slave laborers. Some will be forced to plow in his fields and harvest his crops, while others will be made to make his weapons and chariot equipment. The king will take your daughters from you and force them to cook and bake and make perfumes for him. He will take away the best of your fields and vineyards and olive groves and give them to his own servants. He will take a tenth of your harvest and distribute it among his officers and attendants. He will want your male and female slaves and demand the finest of your cattle and donkeys for his own use. He will demand a tenth of your flocks, and you will be his slaves. When that day comes, you will beg for relief from this king you are demanding, but the Lord will not help you." But the people refused to listen to Samuel's warning. "Even so, we still want a king," they said. "We want to be like the nations around us. Our king will govern us and lead us into battle." So Samuel told the Lord what the people had said, and the Lord replied, "Do as they say and give them a king." Then Samuel agreed and sent the people home. And that's the end of 8. I hope you'll join me tomorrow for 1 Samuel 9 through 14. Have a blessed day. Peace.